Colossae was actually a thriving city. The key production was wool. Strabo, one of the writers of the first century, notes that the city drew a great revenue from flocks, and Colossae gave its name to the color Colossinus. So one of the colors of wool is Colossinus, named after the city, Colossae. This region was run by the Greeks, and then the Roman Empire, when they conquered Greece, they took over running it, and there were major roads running between all these cities. So you could get from the one city to the other on major roads. This particular city, whilst it was a thriving city, 60 AD was destroyed by an earthquake, and this is all that's left of it. That green little hill, it's known as the Mound. You can go and visit it in Turkey today. That's all that's left of the city of Colossae. They were also known for other things. They were known for coexisting in peace. They were a peaceful city. They loved hanging out with the sheep, you know, and they loved the sharing community. And one of the things they were more well known for was that their faiths got along with each other very well. And coexistence is known as syncretism. Syncretism. This is the ideology that all religions can just get along with one another. It's an ideology that says that we can coexist, that we don't have to fight one another, we don't have to argue with one another. We have to understand that to be a thriving city, to be a thriving city today, some of the biggest cities in the world today, like New York and London, they have more than 300 spoken languages in the city. And there is an edifice built to just about every kind of religion in those cities. You can go to just about any type of temple in those cities. And when you come to cities like that, that there's a language, there's a culture, there's an understanding, there's a democracy. There's a rule of law. There's a kind of your rights are protected and your religion is protected and you have the right to practice your religion. All these things. These are, you know what? These are good things. But coexisting is not the same thing as unity. And, you know, syncretism has a voice. One of the more famous voices of syncretism is in our lifetime. Well, not all of our lifetime. The millennials won't remember him, but we certainly do. John Lennon. Imagine all the people sharing all the world. A very famous song by John Lennon, it says, imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. No hell below us, above us, only sky. Imagine all the people living for today. Imagine there's no countries. It isn't hard to do. Nothing to kill or die for, and no religion too. Imagine all the people living life in peace. You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you can join us and the world will be as one. You believe that? You are in dangerous territory. This is what the city of Colossae was built on. Coexistence is a lie. Coexistence is a false unity. Coexistence, that we can all just get along, is not biblical. When I was putting this talk together, when I got to this point, the image that came to my mind was the Tower of Babel. When all mankind got together to build a tower so that we could be like God. And then I reflected on that. And I noticed that how many major cities around the world are building structures that reach into the sky. And it is as if there's a race going on as to who can build the highest and tallest structure. In many of these structures, people don't even live in it. It's just to say, look what we have achieved. And humanity is all about doing things together. Humanity is all about getting along and coexisting. There is a need for peace. You know, in our world needs peace. Our world desperately needs peace. The reality is that they're not prepared to have the peace that God wants to give. Trust brings rest. Obedience brings peace. Now, it's ironic that in the first book of the Old Testament, the Lord speaks to us about this tower that men build. There's the structures that people want to build to the glory of mankind and humankind. And we want to elevate humans to the status of God. And when we find ourselves in that trap, we can have a language that helps us. I'm a man of peace. I just want to help everybody. It's amazing that people who write these books, they make the most money out of it. Why can't we just all get together? Marvin Gaye sang that song. I mean, guess I'm dating myself now. You didn't have to say yes so loudly. It wasn't necessary. I'm setting this as a backdrop to the city because we think that this is a new thing. And Paul writes to the church in Colossae. In chapter 2, verse 6, he simply says, therefore. Therefore. Now, I've been taught as a scholar, whenever I see the word therefore, I need to check what it's there for. So in the verses preceding Colossians 2, verse 6, and I'm starting at the end of Colossians 1, and I'm reading from verse 24. Now I rejoice in my suffering for your sake, and in my flesh I do my share on behalf of his body, which is the church. This is an inconvenient truth. I do my share on behalf of the body, which is his church, in filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions. So, Paul says, I do what I do for his body. I've been called to serve the body, and the body is his church. Jesus came to save the world. And this is a very convenient truth. We need to remember when Christ came, he didn't come for the church. The scriptures clearly say when Christ came, he came to save the world. He didn't come to condemn the world. He didn't come to judge the world. He came to save the world. And we need to remind ourselves of why Christ came. He didn't come so you can have good bumpy feelings in all of that. And no, Christ didn't come for that. He came to save you. He came to save you from your wrong thinking, from the way that you thought when you were building your own little tower. And he did this in filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions. So the point is this, when we focus on the church and we're pointing out all the things that the church is not doing, Paul says, in filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions, is there anything that's lacking in Christ? But when Paul writes this, he's writing to them, he's saying, when you think there's lack in what Christ has done, then you will feel the need to fill it with something. And that is where you make room for other ways of thinking. Of this church, I was made a minister according to the stewardship that God bestowed on me for your benefit, so that I might fully carry out the preaching of the word of God. You know, people place a very low value on the preaching of the word of God. Today you can get lots of preaching on the internet. You can download sermons. I want to say to you, if you're living off canned food, do not be surprised if you get metal poisoning. There are so many sermons that you can download today. There are so many preachers that you can follow today. But I want to say to you, if you don't know that person, don't follow them, because you don't know them. God has given you somebody to preach to you, and I get paid to do it. And you pay me. Now, I'm not saying that you only have to listen to me, but I'm saying be careful of listening to all these messages and you thinking that we can just all get together. We can all get along. We can all coexist. The church belongs to Christ, and that Christ is in the church. He says this has been hidden from the past ages and past generations, but has now been manifested to his saints, to whom God willed to make known what is the riches of the glory of the mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Now listen, Christ in you is an inconvenient truth. Because Jesus is not coming back to the world to save the world again. When he's coming back, the scriptures are very clear on this fact. He's coming to fetch the church. Now that's not convenient. When you preach this message, you're not going to be popular. But what about the people who believe in something else? Are you saying, yes, that's not convenient. Coexistence. Now, we are in the world, but we're not of the world. So the tension that we live in because of the mystery of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that is Christ in you, the hope of glory. The tension that brings is very real. That we don't know everything. What we prophesy in part. We know in part. We only have a deposit of what is to come. But the deposit that we have is not the deposit of something else. Here's what I'm going to say. If the Lord has given you a deposit of what's to come, then it's like he's taken a cake, cut out a slice, given you a piece, and say, taste this. Now, when you taste that piece of chocolate cake with caramel on top and cream in the middle and a bit of strawberry jam. Oh, sorry, that was a bit too graphic. And as you bite into it and you feel the weight pile on. And he says to you, this slice is only a deposit of what I'm going to give you. Then here's what you can expect. You can expect the whole cake. And so what you taste now, what you bite into now, and the flavor that you get of the Holy Spirit now is not going to be any different to what is still to come, but it's going to be so much more. So, you know, when the Lord heals somebody now, it's for now. It doesn't mean that they stay healed. The man that Jesus raised from the dead, Lazarus, the brother of Mary and Martha, he died again when Jesus didn't come back to raise him again. But he is coming again to raise us all at the resurrection. That's what Martha was talking about. When Martha says, I know that you're coming at the resurrection and that we will all be raised with you. He says, I am the resurrection. If you know me now, you know the resurrection. And what is going to come in the resurrection, you can have a deposit of it now. Because when the resurrection comes, there'll be no sickness. There'll be no need for healing. But right now, you can have a deposit of it. Have some healing. We are all going to die of something. But we are all going to be raised to life in Christ. And when Christ in you, the mystery of the gospel is that Christ in you is not just for you, but you can take it to others. And so I want to encourage you this morning, because Christ in you must spill out of you. Because we proclaim him. And we don't only proclaim him with words. We don't only proclaim him by coexisting with others and being nice to others. You know what? Some of the nicest people I know are not even Christian. In fact, most of the nicest people I know are not even Christian. And I'm not saying that Christians are not nice people. But sometimes we proclaim so much that we forget to love. We proclaim so much that we forget that Christ says, even if I raise the dead, if I do miracles, if I speak the language of angels, if I do all these things, if I do not have love, I am nothing. And I want to say to Christian, I want to say to all of us, we need to love. We need to love the world. We must love the world like Christ loved the world. He loved the world and gave his life for it. When you love the world, are you prepared to give your life for it? Even if they're the ones killing you? The ones that Christ came and died for killed him. Because he refused to back down on the truth. I am. Before Abram was, I am. I am the Messiah. I am the light that has come into the world. When John the Baptist proclaimed him, yea, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. When you make proclamations like that, the world doesn't like it, and they will stone you. And they will throw stones at you, and they will bring your house down. But we lay down our lives for them, like our father did with the first son. And we, who are then the harvest of that resurrection, God did not spare his son, and why should he spare his sons? We are the sons of God. And those who are the sons of God, we must be willing to proclaim him and lay it all down for the world. We don't have to coexist. We don't have to be. But here's the thing that all the people in Colossae would have understood. Knit together in love. You see how awesome this particular verse is. It's right in the middle of what he wants to say. He says, we are knit together in love. Now, to a people who make wool, this makes absolute sense. And even though Colossae doesn't exist anymore, you still get tapestry from Turkey. You still get mats that they produce of the highest quality. In fact, it will cost you more than your car to have a mat to walk on when you buy a Persian rug, when you buy things made. He says, but when you're knit together and you're woven together, and today the Lord is telling us, I am bringing you together. I am wanting you to understand. I am the true north. You need to know who I am. I am your God. I'm the only God. There's none but me. Inconvenient. Inconvenient. But we must proclaim it, not just with words. Let me tell you something. Far too many of us are using too many words to tell people about Jesus. But Paul says this, we proclaim him, admonishing every man and teaching every man with all wisdom, so that we may present every man complete in Christ. And of course, the word man here is a generic term. And in the original Greek, it's about every person. Every believer. For this purpose, I also labor, striving according to his power. Striving according to his power, which mightily works within me. So there is a power within you. And that power is not just to give you the goosebumps and to slay you in the spirit and to make you feel full and full of everything that you are designed. We must remember that he empowers us so that we don't get confused about who God is and that we don't follow any delusions of grandeur. Some people are very good at putting their point across. Some people love argument. I mean, I get a text at least once a week from a certain person that knows me. Every week, he thinks up another thing to argue with me about. I'm not going to mention that person's name. I'm just going to say, I'm not here to argue with people. And I don't have to convince you that Jesus is your Lord if you are constantly arguing about whether he's your Lord. If you need to find proof that Jesus is your Lord, stop trying to prove who he is. Taste and see that he is good. I want to say to you, I can argue. I have a particular memory of when I was in matric. I won't say the year. But it was not long after Noah built the ark. And in that year, I was part of the debating team at our school. And I went to school in a time when our schools were segregated. So I went to a school that was for my people group. I was given an identity by the state that told me that I belonged to a particular people group, and I had to go to a school allocated for that group. But in the 80s, we were resisting the government. We were making petrol bombs and confronting Caspers and shouting freedom songs and saying, we don't need no education, we don't need no thought control. And Pink Floyd really became a mantra for the generation. And we stood up and resisted the system. And we sacrificed so that the generation that lives now, that have the opportunities they have now to study where they want to study and live where they want to live, need to remember that there's a generation following you that can't go back to the way things were. People have given their lives so that you can have your freedom. Don't throw it away. I'm not just shouting at them, I'm shouting at all of us. I want to say, take what you receive, build on it. We laid down and we were prepared to sacrifice whatever it took to get the job done. And I wanted to know, I'm proud to be part of that generation. I'm proud to be part of that generation, but it doesn't define me. And I remember having a debate, because it was then when the schools started opening up and gray areas became the new term. Gray areas where there was a mixing and a coexisting. A coexisting. And I was on the debating club and we had to debate this topic, and I didn't believe this at all. I had to debate with another girl who was a very good debater, by the way. She was the head girl of our school. And I had to debate with her that it was okay to go to these new open schools. And her point was to debate that it's not okay. And she had to then give her points of why it is not right for us to go. And I debated her. And I gave my point of view so well that 2 days later she left our school and went to an open school. And I didn't even believe that that was right. So I wanted to say this. The point of an argument is to win an argument. It's not to establish truth. I didn't even believe what I was saying to that girl, but I convinced her that I was right to the point that she left our school. So Paul says, I don't come to you with eloquent speech and great arguments, but I come to you with what? A demonstration of the power of God. Listen, we don't need no education. We don't need no thought control. We don't need more arguments. We don't need to make our point. We need to know who our true north is. His name is Jesus. And we need to set our compasses according to him and then run the path that has been mapped out for us. Slight deviation from our path there in our ministry, but I want to come to the therefore. Now we come into the home straight. Therefore. What was it therefore? Number one, verse 6. Therefore, as you have received Christ as Lord, so walk with him. Since you've received him, walk with him. I know it sounds simple, but we are all like sheep. We keep going astray, each to our own way. We have Jesus, but hey, he keeps walking that way. What is wrong with him? I'm going this way. Why are you going that way, Jesus? We're going this way. I don't know about you, but I wish the Lord would just follow me so I can show him where we're going. You know that sense? It sounds obvious, isn't it? We've received him, so walk with him. You know, when you feel like you're far from Jesus, I need to ask you the question, which way are you walking? Because he hasn't moved from where he was going to. And he's not going to change his mind about where he's going. Now, I like what he's doing here, what Paul is doing here, because he did it when he spoke to the church in Corinth as well. He says, being firmly rooted, being firmly rooted. You know, again, the church is the body of Christ. It's not convenient, but it's true. Jesus didn't come for the church, he came for the world. Not convenient, but it's true. And he came because he loved the world. Now the most inconvenient truth is, and when he comes again, he's coming for the church. He's coming for the church. And I want to say this to people. if I'm going to marry Lynette, and you are one of my friends, but you've got nothing nice to say about my wife, future wife. You're my friend. We were like homies. You know, we fought together in the struggle. We now are living in the freedom of the new South Africa, and we're born in the new SA. And we are now living for our lives to make a difference and an impact to every generation. You, my best friend, you are there, but you're constantly talking rubbish about my future wife. Don't be surprised if you don't get invited to the wedding. Does that make sense? The church is the bride of Christ. Stop talking rubbish about her, or you won't get invited to the wedding. Aina, be careful what you say about the church. The church is not perfect, but it is Christ's bride. And you might love Jesus, and you might love walking with him, but if you keep going after his bride, don't be surprised if you're not invited to the wedding. For I want you to know, Paul says, that I have struggled with this. Therefore, walk with him, established, firmly rooted, and built up in him. So Paul used the two things. And if you think of Jeremiah, the Lord says, I've called you to uproot and to tear down, to plant and to build. We are called to build and to plant and to be rooted, having firmly been established on what Jesus says, established in your faith. We need to be established in our faith. And just as you were instructed, Paul says, and he was saying, just as I instructed you, and overflowing with gratitude. Brother, sister, friend, be established on the foundation of your faith, Christ Jesus. Be rooted in to his bride. Get connected. Stop doing things in your own strength and trust that the Lord is able to empower you to be the person that he's called to be. Keep your true north focused on the Lord Jesus Christ. Keep walking the way that he has called you to walk. Establish yourself in your faith so that you won't be swayed by petty argument and deluded by false beliefs. We're not called to coexist with the world. We are called to walk in unity with our brother and our sister. For by this all men will know that you are my disciples, that you have love for one another. He's not talking about love for the world. And love covers a multitude of sin. Have I wronged you? Do you have the strength to forgive me? Forgive me, not because I'm sorry. Forgive me because you love me. Yo, this is not easy. People offend me so easily. They're always talking junk about me, Pastor. Nobody loves me in this place. No, Jesus loves you. Your Father in heaven loves you. And if you're not sure, I love you. I love you. Not the pastor there on TBN. He doesn't even know that you exist. Oh, yeah. People don't mind having the pastor on TBN preaching to them. They don't mind giving their money to that pastor either. But when their life falls apart, Pastor Craig, I need help. I'll say, phone that pastor from TBN. Now, I want to just say this to you. I believe that they're doing a great job of spreading the gospel. And I want you to understand that Jesus isn't coming for a church on TV. He's coming for a church that is rooted, established, planted, and living in unity. How can you live in unity with somebody that you do not know? The reason that he places you in a body is to form you into a spiritual formation. He tries you in these environments, and he tests you, and he shapes you, and he molds you into the child that he wants you to be. Now, this is not a message about church. This is a message about Jesus. It's not convenient the way that he's chosen to do this thing, but we have to surrender to it, and we need to guard our hearts against getting this wrong and falling into the trap of the church in Colossae, who thought they could coexist with every philosophy of the day and that they could just get along together. Imagine that words of John Lennon, they are so powerfully worldly. But there's another song called Imagine. I can only imagine what it must be like when I see you, Jesus, and I stand by your side. Will I worship you, Jesus? Will I be able to talk at all? Will I sing before your throne? Will I be able to stand at all? Oh, I can only imagine. And so for the joy set before us, let us endure what we have to endure so that we can be together in unity in the love of the fellowship of the bride of Jesus Christ. The bride for which he died and for which he's coming back to redeem all things unto himself. So therefore, let us not give in. Let us not give up. And as we heard this morning, let us never quit. Let us keep going. For the God who has come to save us is the one who will bring us home. Amen. Let's stand.